Welcome to the NFA virtual event series. My name is Millie Harrod, and I am the membership manager here at the NFA. The NFA was founded in 1972 as a common ground for flutists to exchange ideas and inspiration. In the years since, it has grown to become one of the world's largest flute organizations with members from all 50 states and countries across the globe. We invite all of you to become NFA members if you haven't already and take advantage of our year-round benefits, including a subscription to the Flutist Quarterly, borrowing privileges from our sheet music library, discounted instrument insurance, and more. So visit nfaonline.org to learn more and join today. We'd also like to acknowledge that today's online event is made possible with support of our members, our donors, and the Illinois Arts Council Agency. Today, we have a very exciting event all about score study with Dr. Mehrdad Gholami, and I will take it away. Or, sorry, can you take it away?
Thank you very much. First, I would like to say hello to everyone. My name is Mehrdad Gholami. I am the assistant professor of flutes at Western Washington University, and I'm also the coordinator of the woodwind department at Western. I'm so happy to be here, and I've been a member since day one that I came to America around 11 years ago, and it's been a long journey with NFA. I really love attending all the conventions, and I really also have been loving these online series, and I'm so happy to be sharing a class today. Okay, I think without further ado, we can get started with the presentation. Let me go ahead and share the screen. All right. Okay, I think this should be working. Good. Well, I'll give you a little bit of a background on how I came about to designing and kind of starting to teaching to this class. This is a very fresh course for me that I've taught this past fall at Western. And over the past years, I've been fortunate enough to play in a lot of different orchestral and chamber settings. And I did 4 summers, 3 in Aspen Festival and 1 in Atlantic Music Festival, which I was the contemporary flute fellow in each one of these festivals. And all of those years of having 1 or 2 rehearsals to prepare a concert and having to play around 16 concerts within 8 weeks of a summer festival, that really, I think, prepared me to be able to function really efficiently. And I had the chance to work with a lot of really good top-notch players around the country and from outside, around the world. That all those experiences taught me a lot about how to show up to a rehearsal really prepared and ready to go. The other side for me was, for years, I always heard from my teachers and my I told my students that, oh, we should score study. We should make sure that we are score studying. But I never went to too much details about what does it mean? What do you study when you open the score? And how do you score study? So I decided to finally design a class and go through some basic concepts on how score studying works. As an introduction, I would like to basically mostly just talk about what's the definition of chamber music, and then we'll talk about the role. Why is it important to score study, and why is it important to write the cues correctly? Then we'll and talk about score study in chamber music, and at the end we'll talk about cue writing in chamber music, which in that section I'll bring a lot of examples from. Mostly flute repertoire, but also some other examples from around the repertoire. So as professional musicians, or even if you're a student, we all have heard the traditional definition of chamber music. What does it mean? What is chamber music? And the traditional definition is telling you that chamber music should be usually 1 per part. It's very intimate, and it's duets or beyond. And it's usually 4 or 5 people. And something that I really started hearing and noticing is that chamber music, the modern definition would be from solo playing to orchestra playing. We can incorporate different elements of chamber music in anything. And that was a big switch for me. I used to watch a lot of the documentaries from Berlin Philharmonic, and every time you hear those performers, they always talk about the fact that they really take a lot of pride in being chamber music players, although they are playing one of the biggest and most prestigious orchestras of the world. So the other thing was the role of score study and cue writing, and what different things that we can learn from this. So the first and the most important thing is the communication and collaboration between and within the ensemble. Another very important thing that we can gain from this is clarity of interpretation. If everybody agrees how the music should be interpreted, then you can communicate that so much better. And the other thing would be balancing dynamics and timbre. Enhance rehearsal efficiency. If you have one or two rehearsals, I remember sometimes we had one rehearsal and then there was a concert. And it's just like that with a lot of orchestral gigs, and just like that with a lot of even church music chamber gigs, that you might get that you have one rehearsal and you need to be there and you need to be very ready. The other thing that you can take away from all these is problem solving. Making sure that you know how to problem solve, you know how to compromise, and that will lead to the next bullet point, which is increased musical awareness, adaptability, compromise, all very good characters of being a good musician and a chamber music player. And finally, it's something that's important for me when I'm watching a performance is the body language of the performers. Are they interacting with each other? Do we think that they know what they have decided to do? And all of these are things that we can take away from score study and chamber music cue writing. So let's start the portion about score studying. We're going to talk about basics, structure analysis, melodical analysis, rhythmic analysis, and dynamics and articulations. In the basics, when you first open the score, the first thing that you are able to take away from the score is going to be the fundamentals. What's the key signature? What's the time signature? What tempo markings? And believe it or not, even these very simple basic facts can save you a lot of time in the rehearsals. There are so many instances that I can remember that I've gone to a rehearsal and the very first question has been, okay, so what's the speed? And you can avoid all of these conversations by just simply looking at it and making a very slightly informed decision before going to the rehearsal. And this doesn't have to be a quintet rehearsal or a quartet rehearsal. This can be a simple duet reading session or a flute and piano rehearsal. The next portion is going to be looking at the structure of the piece. Identify the overall structure of the composition, including sections, movements, or any significant divisions. Look for recurring themes, motifs, or patterns within the music. If you just skim through the score, you realize that, oh, maybe there is this really hard flute variation that I need to make sure that I'm playing and practicing. And just looking at your part, that might not give it away, the fact that you're the soloist in that section. The next bullet point is analysis. And this is not truly necessary right away unless you are very serious about if you're recording something or you're very serious about giving your best performance of the piece. And it includes analyzing the harmony, the chord progressions, if it applies to the music, modulations used in the piece, paying attention to key changes and their significance. Is it a modulation or is it just a temporary key change? And this will give you a lot of extra inputs to be able to be efficient in your interpretation. And there are other bullet points like melodic analysis, like rhythmic analysis, and that goes into the meter, the rhythm, and the pulse of the piece. And these are all very important things that, with simply going through the score, you can just immediately recognize a lot of good hints for your upcoming rehearsals. And at the end, dynamics and articulation, depending on what the piece is telling you, you can take away a lot of information from just simply looking at that. And there are a few further points that you can understand from just simple basic score study is to look at the composer and see what was the historical and the musical context of the piece. If you're playing a piece that has a lot of references to a specific other piece, it's good to know when was it written? Did the composer know that other composer? And this really puts things into the perspective to really reach a good interpretation. Listening and recording. We all have heard I jokingly call it the myth of don't listen to the recordings to my students, is that we all have heard that, well, try to avoid listening to recordings. But the reality is that even, let me see if you have a, yes, that is a Picasso drawing, then good catch. We all know that, at least with my level and my students and a lot of people that I know, I do take a lot of input from different types of recordings. And the fact that if you're making an informed decision to listen to recordings and being able to interpret them and not necessarily copy them, that's actually a very modern tool that we have. That we have all these superstar flute players right in our phone able to play for us, which is a fantastic tool. And then there are further things like score reading with the ensemble. So everybody holds on to the score and goes through it, and everybody tells their opinion about, oh, this is the section that I feel like so-and-so should be important. This is the flute variation. This might be the place that we need to make sure we decide on different things. And that, along with the group study, that can really help to foster the sense of community within the ensemble and talk through a lot of things that can prevent a lot of confusion in the future. All right, going to the next slide. So from score study, we want to take away something from studying the score, right? And that will bring us to the next portion of our presentation, that what are cues? What does it mean to write cues? And why are they important? Cues can be anything that helps you understand, communicate, and guide any aspect of your performance with other people or in the performance that you have coming. They can be physical cues, just like nodding, conducting, breathing. They can be visual cues, even sometimes making eye contact with an ensemble member. That's very important. They can be auditory cues, that you are waiting for somebody's note or rhythmic pattern to come in. And most of these can be written cues that you have made sure to specifically, as we will talk later in the presentation, write and make sure that you have written and communicated with yourself in a way that no matter what happens, you can remember what that cue means. And I think that we already have talked about the importance of why it really helps with your performance. But it's good to review that it really helps with your communication and efficiency. And I've had the opportunity to play with Kaleidoscope Chamber Orchestra, and we did two flute concertos without a conductor. And I remember that we had three rehearsals, and we had to do Brandenburg number 5, and we had to do a piece by Gabriella Smith, and we didn't have a conductor. So everybody came in with enhanced parts that we exactly know who is giving the cue in what part of the, and that was that enabled us to perform these two fairly complex pieces without a conductor. So they're really, really important. Plus, they kind of make the whole ensemble come to life and become a little bit more active and engaging to the audience, which I'm guessing that's the hope for a lot of us. Now, let's talk about some important physical cues. I mentioned eye contact and more, and this is where it starts. Sometimes just looking at your chamber music partner, that's really, really important for that sense of security. If you have played in an orchestra, you realize that before a big solo coming up, it's really important for you to be hyper aware and make sure that you are putting the conductor or your section at ease by just communicating with them that, hey, I know this is coming up. If you are playing a string instrument, the bow movements is going to be another very, very important thing. Breathing, as flute players and even for non-flute players, breathing is a very important tool that we have. And we can really divide it into smaller portions like how am I breathing, how long I am breathing to bring the chamber music group back in. I recently played Hindemith Sonata, and my pianist was telling me that she's had a couple of bad experiences with the beginning of the third movement. So we had a very specific arrangement that I am breathing in this very specific dotted half note. So she exactly knows that when I go, the movement starts. So breathing is really important. Head nods, simple but very, very important. And if you have watched a good string quartet play, you know that body sways are a thing that a lot of traditional chamber music groups with woodwind quintet, with brass quintets, or string quartets use that. Now, let's talk a little bit about written cues and why they are very, very important. And we can usually when we are talking about written cues, we can always talk about the basic elements that these are usually very personal. These are our personal cues. They can be about rhythm, and most of these rhythm are for personal use. But another important, but sometimes mistakenly kind of taken at the same category, is the pulse. And pulse is something that you should be making that decision within the ensemble and looking at the score. So score study and eventually writing these cues helps a lot with your understanding of pulse. And all of these things helps with deciphering the composer's intents. So making sure that you are within the ensemble. After you have made decisions about your rhythm and your playing, you talk about pulse. What is the pulse? And we do have a good example from a Beethoven trio that we will go through. And these were the mostly personal elements. And the other categories are ensemble cues, that these are interpersonal. For example, entrances. It's really important to know that entrances shouldn't be generated from the same person always. It's so easy to think that in the context of a woodwind quintet, oh, the flute player should always breathe and give you the entrance. But there are many pieces, like one of the ones that we will review today, that the flute player is not necessarily the person in charge. I mean, it might be the horn player, it might be the bassoon player having to take a really good breath. So entrances are really important. Again, rhythm and pulse, but disgust within the ensemble are very, very important categories. And the last, before we get to our examples, but the most important thing that I think that you should take away from today's class is how to write these cues. And a very short conversation with the ensemble can really be helpful because we all have seen the students who come to the lesson and they start circling the notes. Or when you go to, I've been to a lot of rehearsals where colleagues, when we are talking about a fairly complex entrance or a fairly complex moment in the music, and I just see a colleague go like that and circling that section. And I don't know, in a week, in 2 weeks, in the next performance, or in 10 years, how can you remember what does that circle mean? So the biggest takeaway from today's class would be replacing your circles with meaningful, always interpretable cues that you can write in your music. Okay. All right, now we are getting to the exciting part, which I really like. For today, we are going to start with two fairly simple but beloved examples of mine. The first one is a piece that I recently performed myself by Valerie Coleman, Fanmi Emen. And the other one is one of the pieces that I've always loved, and it might be my most favorite piece of flute repertoire and flute history, Chant Dolinos by André Jolivet. And these are two very simple examples that first we are going to listen to the selection that I've picked, and then we are going to, and while listening to it, I want you to look at the score and see what are some of the key takeaways. And then I'll show you the annotated version of the score. And then we are going to listen back again just on the flute part, having added those cues to the flute part, and realize how much easier it is to follow and be aware of the music. Okay, let's get started with Valerie Coleman's Fanmi Emen. This is Alexa Steele's and Evan Hines' performance that recently came out. I highly recommend this. This is the first page of Fanmi Emen. This was just the opening, and it might be very unassuming, but believe me, putting it together with piano is not going to be easy, and it might take a good 10-15 minutes chunk of your rehearsal. But with simply recognizing some of these small moments in the opening, you can really lead the rehearsal in a way that's you're completely aware of the piano parts, and then you just play through with your accompanist. And I have two, five, seven, and nine moments selected in this opening. That's it's very simple, and it's a very introductory example, but you'll see how much it will be helpful when you see the flute part. So the first one up is the fact that you come after the piano both times on both of those reiterations of the theme. Then your 4-4 measure in the second line is going to be fairly aligned with the piano part. And then at the end of the second system, after your triplet, you need to make sure to cue back the pianist in. And do you see that load? Let me see if I can annotate this. Yes. If you look at this load notes, you see that it comes one eighth note before this high B, that you have this low D and then high B, and then the pianist plays the low note. And these might be very minor, but once you go to the rehearsal and once you're aware of them, they can be big lifesavers. And then here, realizing that again, after one of those eighth notes, you have that chord that you need to be cueing the pianist because they have a good view of you, and then just making sure that you are waiting for that. And all of these, having transposed them to the score for the flute player, would look something similar to this. For example, here, let me keep annotating here. Okay. Here you have made sure to write that the pianist has that chord at the end of your note, so you're not taken aback. Then here you have made sure that you know that pianist plays a glissando chord, and then you know that you should be the one cueing the piano. And then you know that some of these are aligning with you. I think that's my score might be a little bit off since I'm annotating it. But then with Each one of these, you can see the, how each one of these cues are going to be very helpful. Okay, I'm going to play the piece again, and this time pay attention to how this is going to be helping you with the score. Great. I think that this specific slide, because I was checking the slides coming up, has been shifted a little bit because I was using an iPad. So I apologize because the cues are a little bit shifted towards the left. But this is a very basic example of how you can use. And the next example is going to be very similar, and it's from Chantolinos by Jolivet. And I think that's, I can delete and erase all these annotations. There we go. Go across the score. There we go. I want you to listen to the whole page and try to come up with ideas that how can you take away things from the piano score that can be very helpful. This is another unassuming moment in Chantolinus that when you played with pianists, because of the presence of so many big duple versus triple meter moments, it's really hard to follow which one is the pulse, which one is a triplet, and which ones are the eighth notes. So let's go ahead and listen to this. And this is from starting from top of the page. If you have had the chance, or if you have had the chance to play Chantolinos before, or just go through the score, you realize that these interludes in the context of a very aggressive, loud piece might be the hardest moments of putting it together with the pianist. Okay, so the score, after you have looked at it and maybe you have picked and selected some spots, might look something like this. Just kind of trying to find what can you take away from the piano part to make sure that every couple of measures, not necessarily every moment of the piece, but maybe every couple of measures, every line or two, you have something to really feel your feet on the floor and say, okay, this is it. I'm together. I'm not completely off. And there are different types. There are things like the top of the page that I'm just basically taking away from the piano part. There are moments that we end, just like the second line, and it's my duty. I realize that, okay, the pianist has ended, and it's a very good opportunity for me to cue in the next measure, so we know that, okay, no matter what goes with the first five measures, we are going to start this measure together. And then in the next line, you realize that in the second movement, after that context of me playing a triplet and the piano coming with an eighth note and another triplet, it's really important to be able to latch on these quarter notes and give each other another moment of peace that we are starting the measure together. And all these moments translated into score look something like that. And if you look at all of these cues, if you look at them now, 2 years from now, or 10 years from now, that you might decide to play Sean Dolinus again, all of them are going to be useful because you exactly know what you are listening to and what you will be responding to. Let's listen to the same portion of Sean Dolinus, but this time with the flute parts and the added cues to your score. Just spending maybe 10 minutes with that one page can save you so much time and bring out a lot of expressiveness, because then you can really let go of the counting and truly enjoy the magic that Jolivet has created for you. All right, moving on, we have two other examples. One of them is from our chamber music repertoire by this trio by Beethoven for flute, clarinet, and bassoon. And the other one is a very good example by Victor Ewald's quintet number one for brass quintet. That's previous quarter I was teaching this piece, I found it a very good example of what to be looking for as far as pulse and how to notate pulse in the context of our discussion today. Okay, the first one, we are going to talk about pulse, entrance, ensemble, activity, and breathing in cues. So that's really, really important to realize that sometimes even with the opening of a piece, it's really important to take a breath in a specific subdivision of the piece. Let's listen to the first two lines of Beethoven's trio for piano, flute, and bassoon. This is truly a gorgeous melody. So with a simple look at the score, you realize that, okay, we know that we are not going to be, as flute players, we are not going to be the first person who starts. And simply, we can risk counting, but it's going to be so much easier to input a couple of different things. Number one is that just knowing that piano and bassoon are going to start the piece together. See if I can annotate here. Okay, there we go. just realizing that, and maybe as an ensemble making that decision that's, hey, why don't we take a breath as an eighth note, in which we can go pa, or why don't we take a breath as a quarter note, which can be two beats, and just realizing that the piece and the pulse of the piece is moving in eighth note because it's so slow, can really help us have a perfect entrance after and we have listened to the introduction of bassoon and piano. So in the next slide, we see that a very simply annotated, let me see if I can go ahead. There we go. And I'm having a lot of issues with this annotate feature. Okay, there we go. We can realize that, okay, well, at the end of the opening section, we hear this piano and the rhythm and stops, and then a simply small word of writing tutti or all together or in any other languages that you want to write it down can help you realize that, okay, this time it's my duty because it's tutti, so it's flutist's duty to take a good breath and bring everybody together. And writing, if you notice here, I have bassoon, piano, unison, and kind of type of the breath, which is going to be a quarter note breath. And going forward, we realize that as a solo, and we this is again our responsibility to cue in the ensemble. And on measure 12, some simple eighth note cues from piano to make sure that we latch our melody with the left hand of the piano player. And in a measure like this that we have, and a couple of measures forward, that we have a more complex rhythm, just simply highlighting each eighth note is going to be saving us so much time beforehand, before we have entered the rehearsal. And at the end, again, writing what happens when we are ending so we can have a better entrance at the end of the line. So this, although it looks very simple, pretty much guarantees, ensures your all of your entrances to be perfectly in the same place. And I'm going to skip the bassoon example so we can get to the Victor Evald brass quintet. Let's listen to the opening. Annotated score, a score that we have in we have studied very informally, would look something similar to this, or more or less. So the meaning of these highlights, I'm going to go one by one through them. The first thing that I notice is that who starts the piece, then from the lens of the first trumpet player, when I am coming in and how do I come in, do I cue the ensemble, do I get the cue from somebody else, and what is happening underneath me when I'm playing my first opening theme, and then what is happening in this space here at the end of the first line, and which leads to my next entrance, and in this sudden change of pulse, it's not a change of speed, and what is happening underneath as far as subdivisions, so I can make sure that I'm latching onto every single other member of the ensemble. And then one of those moments of emergency break and peace, it's happening right before three, where the whole ensemble is playing in unison. So this could be a very good checkpoint in the in this long trail that we are hiking together, that okay, everybody, you make sure that you're standing on this checkpoint right before three, and then we have two unison, very important calming chords. And then let's go to the parts of the first trumpet. to see what is happening. Luckily, sometimes you get a part like this that the trumpets are coming both together. So you have already some incorporated cues in your score. But even that can be enhanced heavily by some simple score studying. For example, just writing the fact that the instruments start, you don't even need to write tuba. You just need to write the rhythm of the opening that goes ta-ra-ra-ra-ra-ra-ra-ra-ra. That makes sure that you know what the quarter notes are. You exactly know the pulse of the piece and you know what is happening, and that ensures you count your success in counting four simple four measures. Then writing lead means that, well, and it can be any word you want. It can be even the name of the person you are supposed to look at. Writing lead ensures that you are leading the ensemble to kind of adjust and get together. For second trumpets, these unison moments with trombone and tuba. And then again, some rhythmic adjustments to make sure that you exactly do a great job counting your rests. And starting at two, I have just written down the powerhouse, the engine part of the music, which goes underneath. So you can find somebody to latch onto. And just a simple highlighting right before three that you can write unison on top, or you can write and make sure that you're cueing everybody, or just simply cue, make sure that the beginning all the way to three is going to be absolutely together. Okay. Going on, I have my last example before we go back to Evolve, if we have time, because I do also want to open the floor for some questions too. This last example comes from Samuel Barber's Summer Music, one of the most beautiful pieces that, as flute players, we are included in it, and it's very exciting for woodwind quintet. And this is a really good tool to learn score study because it's so versatile. It changes so fast and so often that unless you have done your part, unless you have done your job of really truly preparing your part, it would be really hard to sit through the rehearsal. Let's listen to a little bit of this section that I've picked out for you. Great. I'm hoping that you were kind of along the way you were planning, or you're already planning your cues with this one. But this is how the score looks like, and it can be intimidating to look at something like this because it's fairly complex. It's some of these mid-century American pieces are very unassuming. It's like Copland's music, but then once you start looking at it, you realize, oh, this is really well crafted, and I really need to know what is happening on the score. So, a simple way, like the simple change from here would be going to here and having realized a few simple just back and forths to make sure that you can latch onto someone, you can find someone. Let me go through all of these and tell you what they mean. Let me pick a different color. There we go. So here at the beginning, right away, I see that we have three repetitions. We also have a fourth one down here, but it because it falls down on a downbeat, we can't recognize it. So I omitted that. And these are the things that you need to learn with experience, that which one is going to be what you need to listen to. So just for the first entrance, after hearing tira, 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 now it's your turn. So that becomes the flute's turn. Or knowing that the next time, especially after this pretty tricky triplets that you need to play, you need to make sure you are latching your eighth note to quarter note to three quarter notes with the oboe player. Or here, knowing that you are going to be doubling with the clarinet player. In this next example down here, you will be doubling with the bassoon player. And this already means that you need to write the cue to make sure that you are looking at the bassoon player, you're taking the breath from the bassoon player, and you're just communicating with the bassoon player because looking at the oboe player is not going to help you much. And writing these cues that fortunately the part for this piece comes with very nice cues. Knowing that here, for example, in down here, you are doubling a very similar melody exactly in unison rhythmically with bassoon again. And here in this interjection, that really helps you be successful for your next entrance. So if you know that the bassoon and clarinet are playing the six-stop play, and you're looking at the horn player waiting for that. So once you hear da da di da da dum, da 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 di ti da ta, so you make sure that your entrance is right on that triplet second eighth note. And again, similar activity in the score, that knowing that you have three iterations, four iterations, and you're the number three of these four repetitions of the same thing. And the next measure, you'll have a back and forth going on with the bassoon line. And then you immediately start latching onto the horn player. So within three measures, you need to make three decisions. And if you have already just looked at the score a little bit and have studied it maybe over a glass of wine or something, it really helps you to show up to a rehearsal that you can be not only very knowledgeable and useful to the ensemble, but help saving so much time for the whole ensemble as a group. Okay, let me see. There we go. I think, oh, okay, I think I learned how to use this thing. Okay, and going on, this is how a normal flute part would look like. Again, it's not heavily marked, but all of these markings are coming in a way that really enhances your experience with the music and also makes you be able to communicate very well. And it's also very good leadership skills because it teaches you compromise. It teaches everybody in the ensemble to compromise and make sure that you can offer something just beyond your part and be a very constructive colleague to everybody who you might be playing the piece with. I think that, and I'm going to wrap it up there today. I do have some other examples from solo repertoire, but I think that we have covered enough for opening the floor for some questions. Thank you so much.
Hi everyone, if you have questions, please put them in the chat or you can turn on your camera and like maybe raise your hand. Very interesting, everything that you shared with us today.
Thank you.
If there are no more questions, I don't know if you want to maybe share another example. We still have a few more minutes. I'm not sure.
I'm getting some thank you notes in the direct messages, but there are no questions, I think. We'll see. We can wait a couple more minutes.
I have a question. So you said that you built this out as a course. So basically, like, is it like the full 18 weeks, and like how do you just like expand, or do you have the students do like different projects on
This
this,
is
or?
part of our the way chamber music works at least where the institution I work at Western, we have quarters, so it's 10 weeks, and we usually offer one or two classes. So the students are also learning some very ba I think we have a question, but I'll finish this first. So the students have some basics of how to approach it, because I've seen that they do learn how to play together, but they don't learn necessarily what are the overarching basic fundamentals of knowing the craft of being a good colleague in the context of a chamber music group. So this is one of the presentations that I'm planning to offer yearly in our fall quarter to kind of begin to kickstart the year, so everybody knows how to score study and what's and this is something I also do in my lessons a lot, that I personally pick up the pencil and write it for my students, and I know that over the years it's going to help them know that okay, I just can't circle something and forget about it. And again, I think that this is even useful information for band directors and orchestra directors to make sure the students are writing down the things that are going to be useful for them. Let me read this question. Oh, that's a really good question. Elizabeth has asked that, what do you do when you don't have the score to study beforehand? And that's a really neat observation, because we have a big body of work. Usually it's 1700s and 1800s, that if you go on IMSLP and download a random quartet by Rossini or something, the chances are that you don't have the score. And if we go back to my slides, I had a bullet point in one of those slides that is basically telling you to sit with your colleagues and score study together. And imagine everybody is holding to their parts, and beforehand you have, this is a very Texas band kid thing, but you have marked all the measures on top. And if the score offers any letters or any big numbers, you know that those are correct and all kind of subscribe to each other. And then with sitting together, you can say that will be a discussion maybe for 20 minutes. You say, okay, I have this thing that looks like a melody at, let's say, 52. What do you have? Oh, you have the same thing? Okay, unison with, I don't know, John, Claire, whoever the person is. Then, oh, I have this thing that looks like an accompaniment. What do you have? Oh, you have nothing. So it's going to be me starting this. So you'll start writing on top of your part, I'm solo here, or solo, or lead, something. Things like that. I feel like that's a lot of community building and very good camaraderie within an ensemble to achieve that all together. I hope that answers the question. But that's a really good observation, because a lot of the time we actually do not have the score. Linda asked, how do you feel about playing from the entire score, e.g., on an iPad, so that you can see all parts, including cues you might have added, versus playing from just the flute part with cues written in? My only issue with that, if the piece, let's say if you're playing a trio or a duet, definitely, definitely, if you already have switched to an iPad. But my only issue is, I have recently also switched to an iPad, and I think that it can be a little bit intimidating having to worry about the flow of the page turns, maybe every two lines. If you're playing a woodwind quintet, the chances of us having two lines, that's like eight measures in a page, can be, at least can be, throw me off. But if it's a duet or a trio, by all means, because it's so much easier. It's so much easier. I do have experiences in the past. I played a piece by Pierre Boulez in Aspen Festival my last year there, that there were two movements That was virtually impossible. So we all played from the score. So that sometimes you have to do it. But most of the time, in my experience, just writing enough cues has helped me just kind of be decently successful within the context of the ensemble. All right, I think those were really good questions. Very, very good questions. Okay, let's see if we have anything else. Thank you everyone for tuning in today. I am currently at a state conference in Yakima, Washington. So I had to come back from the conference and sit and teach the class. But I've been very excited about this class for months, and it's just a passion of mine to play with other people. And I hope that you took away something from it. I hope it was useful for everyone. Thank you so much.
It was awesome. This will be recorded. If you want to send this to your colleagues or your friends, I think this information is very, or your students, this information
Absolutely.
is very helpful. It will be in our on our YouTube channel along with the rest of our virtual event series here in the next like week or so. We do have virtual events every Sunday through the end of April. So if you want to check out our website for that, thank you, Dr. Gholami, for
Thank
your
you very much.
presentation.
Thank you very much.
And we'll hopefully we will see all of you next week for our next virtual event.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you.